So they're giving me signal, then I can start. So hello, everyone. Thank you for coming. I'm Filipe, and I'm going to be giving you a talk about the remix culture in the demo scene. A little bit about me. I'm an informatics engineer from Portugal. I've been a demo scener since 97. I'm a member of the Topolm demo group. One of my most famous tracks was a soundtrack for that demo by Farbrush, which was nominated, which was why I put it there. This presentation is also on my website later, so if you want to check it, there's some links to other stuff that I did. I also have a net label, and I used to be a scene.org staff and an administrator at Puet. And on top of that, I also used to organize a demo party called Inertia Demo Party. So yeah, lots of scene stuff for too many years. So I'm here to tell you about a little bit about the demo scene origins, how that relates with copyright concerns, what the remix culture is, and what the remix culture in the demo scene has been lately. So first up, demo scene origins. As everyone knows, it started with the crack intros on Commodore 64. You used to crack pirate games and put a small crack intro in front of it. This happened on the Commodore, on the Atari, on the Amiga as well, so lots of different platforms. And back in those days, ripping material was completely normal. For example, we have this production called the Samantha Fox Slideshow, and it consisted entirely of a small intro with a ripped logo, like those hands are ripped from a game. And the production itself was all slideshows of Samantha Fox, and soundtrack also by Samantha Fox. And people would decide themselves if the production was cool or not, depending if it was OK, if they liked it or not. This is important, and I'll tell you why in a bit. So as demo scene progressed, we started having mega demos and that kind of stuff. And the pirated material started being measured against original material. So for example, this demo from Red Sector was awesome because it had lots of original material, like the creators were really talented, as opposed to the other stuff. But there are lots of demos which still have lots of ripped material. For example, this demo, State of Mind, from Bomb, got second place at the Party 98, used a commercial soundtrack from Sensor. And another very famous one is using a soundtrack from Fear Factory, is the invitation for the VIP 2 demo party, and the actual one, Takeover 2000. But as the years progressed on the demo scene, we started having more problems with copyright. So for example, this demo, Saint from Alcyon, was disqualified at an assembly in 97 because it used a small clip of a video that they did not have copyright to use. And everyone that sees this demo loves this demo, and it was disqualified. Same thing happened with I Feel Like a Computer. Does anyone remember this demo? It was awesome demo. I really loved it, disqualified, because it used copyright music. Yeah, but OK, we can do a parenthesis here. It's lame if you steal someone else's track and claim that it's yours, so they should have credited it. But well, more on this later. More demos. We started reaching a point where creators actually think, OK, if I want to release this, I need to get permission. So this demo, for example, Barn of TDA, was supposed to be released at Assembly. And they tried to contact the guys. And it's a track from Bob Marley, for those who don't know it. They did the demo entirely on the soundtrack, so it's impossible to get a new soundtrack. The demo would not make that much sense. And they couldn't get permission in time. They got lots of bureaucracy, so they couldn't submit it. And they submitted to Inertia Demo Party instead. And it won, and it was nominated for a scene.org award. And everybody loves it. So and it was intended for Assembly. So this is just as I'm focusing on Assembly demos that got disqualified to make a point that I'm not saying anything about the rules at Assembly itself, although I used to be a big advocate against these kind of concerns. But the bottom line is that they need to have these rules because it's such a big party that it's impossible to run it and not come against organizations that want to charge you money for these kind of things. So they have to put in these rules. And the result is that lots of these cool demos never get shown, or they get disqualified. So they don't get the problem. So we're getting into copyright concerns. I'm sorry I'm speaking a bit too fast, because I have lots of stuff to show. But if someone has any doubts, please just raise your hand and feel free to interrupt. Copyright concerns. So what are the problems with copyright concerns? The parties have financial legal pressure to have everything proper according to the law. Otherwise, they'll get sued and get whipped off. Creators have difficulties getting permission. If they want to use copyright material, it's very hard to get to who owns the permission to use stuff like that. The repositories that host the tracks, like scene.org, have problems because they have to deal with the MCA takedowns. Like, for example, you have a cover of a Super Mario track, even if the track just samples a couple sounds and has the same file name saying Super Mario Remix or something, we still get a letter from Nintendo saying, okay, you're using this track. They haven't even heard the track. They just saw a file name with Super Mario in it. So, and they send you an email saying, okay, you have to put this down. It's our, how do you call it? It's not property, intellectual property. It's our intellectual property. You cannot have anything similarly related to this. And it's a big concern for us, people who are running these repositories, because we want to preserve the culture of the things that have been released, and we have to deal with these problems. And also, there's a very gray area on what concerns fair use, because there's this law that you can use other copyright stuff if you're making a different kind of use for it, and it's called fair use. So you don't need to have copyright if everyone clearly recognizes the original origin and that it's a completely different thing. You're not claiming that it's yours, you're just making something different out of it. So that exists, at least in the US, I think it's official law. I'm not sure on the European side. But the problem with this law is that even the people who try to enforce it don't really know where the gray area is. So you get lots of lawyers sending letters anyways, even if it is fair use, because they're not really sure themselves what it is. So solutions for these problems. One, you can use 100% original material, but you have a downside. Who decides what is original and what isn't? It's very hard to tell. Like, especially in the digital age, if it's all just bits and bytes, so how do you relate that this one is closer to that? If I change one bit, is it a different stuff or is it the same? So it's a very gray area to define. So second solution you can have is screw the system. I don't care about this. I'm going to just release my thing on the internet, and that's it. So you can't release to bigger parties like Assembly because it will get disqualified. But screw it. I'm just doing demos for the fun of it. Or you can use peer-to-peer or temporary download to still spread the stuff around. The problem is that this also has a downside, because repositories that want to keep the culture and preserve it and show it to other people afterwards will have legal problems with that. And the culture will end up getting lost. Like, there are lots of old abandonware games that were not, you couldn't pirate them, and now you can't, it's very hard to find legal copies of it, and people want to see them again, but they're lost in the basement of some people who bought them, all because of this kind of limitations. So the fourth solution is you go just Creative Commons. You, instead of going through commercial stuff and picking things you want to use, you can just go through a Creative Commons repository, and then the things that you pick, you already know that you have a proper license to use it. Of course, those things are not the commercial things that you originally had the idea for, so you still have lots of limitations there. So all these solutions are all have their downsides, so it's not a very clear-cut solution. So this is where we are on the system. That circle, yellow circle, is where the money is. And the green circle is where the people who want to make their stuff available for everyone to do whatever they want are. So they want to get a bit of the money if they can, but they don't really care all that much. Then we have the blue one, which is the completely free, and I don't want any money, money is evil kind of people. I represent them by Stallman, I hope that's okay. On red, it's the mafia lobbyists. Everyone knows what mafia is, right? It's a merge of RAAA and MPAA. I call it mafia. So all the organizations who are trying to get you money for the big entertainment industries. So in the mafia industries have some relation with the content that wants to get spread normally, and they have lots of relations with money. They're mostly interested in money. And then we have the consumers. I represent them by the pirate party, because they use a little bit of everything and they don't really care. They don't mind paying sometimes, and they don't mind giving some money to the mafia lobbies, but they just want access to everything. They don't really care about what's free and what's not. So this is the big picture, and it would be a perfect world if all these circles would be just one, but apparently that's not possible. What's happening here? Okay, so other scenes afflicted. I think I jumped a slide. No, okay. So other scenes afflicted by these copyright concerns, it's not just the demo scene. The ROM hacking scene also has lots of problems with this. They do translations of game that never got released into English, and after 5 years of development translating the game, they get a DMCA takedown notice that they have to destroy all copies of the game, and the game that they were translating for 5 years suddenly cannot see the day of light, even if they want to release it for free. And also remixing games, that's also very common on ROM hacking scene, and it's very shady territory if what you can do and what you cannot. The game mod scene is very similar as well. Machinima scene, anyone knows what Machinima is? One person? Okay, so it's three persons, okay. So they basically videotape games, and they make storytelling out of it. So they're making movies just with game engines. That's called Machinima. So they also have some restrictions on these kind of things. And of course, console hacking, people want to use consoles for other stuff, but since the companies don't want people to pirate games, you always have lots of creative problems. But let's get into what the remix culture is. Any questions so far? None. Okay, great. Remix culture, what the remix culture is. It's impossible to talk about remix culture without talking about hip-hop. So everybody knows hip-hop, I hope, yes? Yes, I'll take that as a yes, as everyone raised their hands. So hip hop basically based around sampling a lot. You couldn't get tools to like professional musicians. I'm talking mostly about the music side of hip hop. You couldn't have lots of gear. Hardware for creating music was very expensive at those days. So they used the turntable a lot, and that developed a bit the whole entire thing around hip hop, where you would find the right records and you would scratch them in at the right time and make a new track out of that. So a good example is this album, Paul's Boutique, from the Beastie Boys. Don't confuse it with the same titled 64K intro that won Mecha Symposium 1998. This demo, this record, Paul's Boutique, was very influential for the hip-hop scene, not just because it was made by white guys, but because it sampled lots and lots of different sources. And they made a calculation recently, and if you try to sample clear all the samples that they use, the record company would lose $20 million just to put the album out. So the album would never be out, one of the most influential hip-hop albums of our days. So same thing happened with the Grey album by DJ Danger Mouse. He made an album. It was completely using lots and lots of samples. The source of his album is called Grey because it mixes the Black album by Jay-Z and the White album by the Beatles. And he mixes samples from both, and he makes a new album called the Grey album. And he released it online for free because he knew no label would put it out. It's too expensive to have sample clearance for all of it. So it got out for free. Another example, Mos Def, same thing, mixing Mos Def with some dub sounds. And there are lots and lots and lots of other albums, especially if you go to dodgy MP3 sites on the web, you can find lots of stuff that was released. They call it white label, because no one knows what label released it. So what the mafia doesn't know about the remix culture is that good artists borrow, but great artists steal. So there's nothing original. Everyone always takes something from somewhere. And if you copy from one, it's called plagiarism, so you can do it. But if you copy from two, it's research, so it's acceptable. So I'm not saying that the completely original material doesn't exist. It does exist, obviously. But most of the stuff that we see nowadays, even on the big Hollywood productions and stuff like that, is derivative from other stuff. And some call it remix. Other people pretend that it's not, but it mostly is. So two important links for you guys if you want to know more about remix culture. A book by Lawrence Lessig explaining why remix culture is important for mankind, I guess, and a video series called Everything is a Remix by Kirby Ferguson, which shows some parallels of Quentin Tarantino movies and George Lucas movies, where they got their inspiration from, and basically telling them everything you see is a remix from something else. You take from your surroundings and you create something new. So, any doubts so far? Okay, so now we're going to the good part, remix culture in the demo scene. So, I'm not saying that you shouldn't steal stuff like our friend Timbaland. So you should give proper notice of the sources that you take stuff from. What happened here? Okay. So, but remixing can be, for example, to make a tribute. Like, for example, these guys made a chiptune album covering Miles Davis tracks. And they called Kind of Bloop. That's the name of the chiptune album. And the guy went to great extent to contact, I think is, yeah, Columbia says here, contacting Columbia Records to make sure that the copyright was gone and they could put it out without getting any lawyers. And the guy from the music label said, well, yeah, sure, you can do, no problem from our side. They put it out, they had no problem. The guy who took the photo came and asked for the copyright because they were making this derivative of his work. So, and they ended up paying shitloads of money because of the cover was pixelated, very closely related to the Miles Davis original album. So, go on. But we have lots of hip-hop influences in demo scene culture, like this demo inside from CNCD was one of the original hip-hop stuff. And I mean, I'm not that much into hip-hop, just to tell you the truth, but this one had lots of Afro-style effects and smoking, snorting glue and that kind of stuff. Some people remixed that demo and made an outside version with some pigs flying around in space and stuff like that, but also with the same aesthetics as inside. And they were made by Melon Design. Some other guys just remixed known pop culture, like Hyperventilation from Byte Rapers. They just took an ABBA song and made some very aggressive beats on top of it and took some scans of some ABBA tracks, and it was an awesome demo. It's one of the best ever. Some people just try to remix a niche culture. Like I don't even know what this niche culture is, but it's about big trucks and lots of niggas cranking their asses. So Farb Rausch made a minus demo, which is the abbreviation they call for when they don't like the outcome, or it's like silly. They make a minus demo called Ghetto Rocker, which had some videos of all this cranking and with some awesome music. And of course, MFX remixed it and did Vanilla Rocker with Vanilla Ice, representing for greater justice. So there are even demos about ripping and what happens, the influences of ripping had in the demo scene. Like this demo talks a lot about that, what's ripping a style, or what's the borderline between the gray area and what's not. Some people remix all kind of influences into one same thing, and you're left thinking, what the fuck is happening here? Like this demo from Calodox had like 007 meeting some, I don't even know the name of the animals, and then Elvis would show up in a casino slow dancing, and Cowboy Wayne would also be there, and we're like, what the hell is happening here? So this is an example of an awesome demo that abuses remixes to the maximum. Some also just do remixes as a joke remake, like these guys were making a remake of the famous Future Crew demo as an invitation for, I think it was Underground Conference, I don't know, it was a party. Some people do remixes as a music disc, like lots of guys did a remix of Variform soundtrack and made it a music disc out of it, so that's also a remix and that's cool, we like that. Some do remixes for pirated demo compos, like at Tomb, they created actually a compo called the Pirated Demo Compo, where you could only enter with demos that would pirate other demos. So it was only allowed for you to take a demo, you could pick a random one, change the graphics, change the soundtrack, and you would have a pirated demo and you could submit it. So these guys, Nuance, made a demo called Mariform. Mariform, so it's, I guess it has some relation to marijuana. And it's a remix of Mariform, of course. Some guys just abused the memes, and Mesa Certified and David Hasselhoff is also always important to have in a demo, David Hasselhoff. This was for, we copied the pirated demo competition idea from Tomb, and we also used it at the Inertia demo party, it was cool. This was one demo I made, actually. It's a remix from Fiat Homo from Traction, which was actually, I think, won here at Assembly, or got second place, something like that, and I called it Honda Gay. Fiat Homo, Honda Gay. Yeah. So another demo that I made a remix, this one was remixing A Deepness in the Sky. I made a dark and long remix with lots of glitches. It was very artistic. Yeah, some other guys did that to piss me off. They made the Knight Rider edit version, where you could hear the Knight Rider theme going. And some other guys even picked to remix it yet again because so many people had remixed it already that they had to do it. So they made the ultimate funk experience in the sky. So the first remix demo that I could find is actually Deep, the Psilocybe remix mix by CNCD and Parallax. I don't know, does anyone remember? You made it. Congrats. Does anyone remember any older demos that used remix than this? Because I couldn't find it, but if anyone knows, it would be cool for me to edit. I found an intro. Actually, someone told me about this intro. Second Hallucination from Stellar is apparently a remix from the First Hallucination, I guess. This is the oldest I can find, but if anyone knows, please let me know and I'll add it afterwards on the I'll credit you on the stuff. So, but for me, the biggest influences on the remix culture on the demo scene is Howjob versus MFX. These guys were so much deep into remixing that at Proxy 2001, they made two remix demos, Howjob remixing MFX and MFX remixing Howjob. So this was one of the demos called Cosmiset Avaro CNET, and I don't remember the name of the original one, so I won't even try to say it. And it was a remix of an original MFX demo. And then we also had an old school tripping mid school news job edit, which was a remix of another demo, which was called Old School Tripping, I guess. Yeah, and both demos were happening at the same demo party, both remixes. So this was like the beginning of the remix culture, at least for me. That was when I was more paying more attention to it. Another big landmark was the Mother Mother series, also by Howjob, and they made Mother Mother My Eyes Hurt, and then MFX did the Mother Mother My Ears Bleed version. And then there were some other Mother Mother versions, like Mother Mother Arcane Won't Sleep With Me by ODD, and a few more, Mother Mother Fuck With Daddy, and Mother Mother There Are Clowns in My Bed. So they really pulled out the series out of that one. Some people, like me, start a call for remixes when they don't like the original demo. I saw this demo called Size Antimatters. I think it was released at an Ailscal party. It was by ASD. And the demo was great, except the soundtrack sucked ass. It was not like supposedly fitting the visuals at all. So I made a page and I said, okay, it's open for remixes. I didn't contact the original authors, but you have to do it because this is wrong. So I got one entry, which was by Valmet Children, and it's this one. Okay, so this apparently sparked something in the ASD guy's mind because they suddenly started doing some remixes as well. One of them was this remix that they did for I don't know what party, but with soundtrack from Excess, and it's more commercial oriented. And the other one they did was with one of my soundtracks, which is which I'm about to show right now. Which actually this demo called Anoxia Redux is a remix from Last Assembly's winner demo, which is Happiness Around the Bend or something like that. Happiness is around something like that. Anyways, they took a soundtrack that I did for an older demo, like from 2004, which is very glitchy and minimal and strange, which you will see in a while. And they made something like this, and they got lots of people hating them for that. I'm a bit famous in the demo scene for killing groups for having experimental soundtracks, so please be kind with AST. I already killed Farbrush 3 times, so it's enough. Let's see, where do I have the demo? Yeah. Demo. I have a video because this is a Mac, it won't run the original, sorry. But. And I hope the sound is okay. It's a bit long, sorry. Please don't fall asleep. The remix of the remix. Thank you. I still have some time. So if anyone has any questions about any of the remixing or remix culture or that kind of thing, please feel free to ask. No one. Okay, I should have gotten more demos to show. Sorry. Well, maybe I can look some up on YouTube. Still have 10 minutes left. So, does anyone? It depends if they're experimental or not. This one did really bad, for example, but some do okay. They end up being a normal demo in the end. People don't really oppose it, generally, for being a remix. That I've noticed, at least. I don't know. Some people might disagree. Yeah, does anyone want to see any of these demos? I can try and look them on YouTube from the ones that I've been showing. Yeah, this one was actually disqualified at assembly as well. I don't know why. It was just extreme noise. Why didn't the jury select it? I have no idea. So I'll try to find some of the earlier ones. Yeah, let me see if this one is available. Please open. If the internet is working. No YouTube. No YouTube. Damn. So close and yet so far. Yeah, maybe Punjabi more. This one is great. Hey, we have 10 minutes. Let's use them, right? YouTube! Yeah, this one got third place at Breakpoint, see? So they're taking pretty well. So, well, I hope there's a video of this one. This is great. It has vanilla eyes, for fuck's sake. Oh yeah, YouTube.
I go crazy when I hear the bass sound. I go crazy when I hear the bass sound. I go crazy when I hear the bass sound. I go crazy when I hear the bass sound. I go crazy when I hear the bass sound. I go crazy when I hear the bass sound. I go crazy when I hear the bass. All right, stop. I go crazy when I hear the bass sound. I go crazy when I hear the bass sound. I go crazy when I hear the bass sound. I go crazy when I hear the bass sound. I go crazy when I hear the bass sound. I go crazy when I hear the bass sound. I go crazy when I hear the bass sound. I go crazy when I hear the bass sound. I go crazy when I hear the bass sound. I go crazy when I hear the bass sound. I go crazy when I hear the bass sound. I go crazy when I hear the bass sound. I go crazy when I hear the bass sound. I go crazy when I hear the bass sound. I go crazy when I hear the bass and hi-hat with a souped up tempo.
Part two, I didn't even remember.
I go crazy when I hear the bass sound. I go crazy when I hear the bass sound. I go crazy when I hear the bass sound. I go crazy when I hear the bass sound. I go crazy when I hear the bass sound.
Is that awesome or what? Okay, yeah, I think I'm out of time. 3 minutes. Maybe we can. Okay, hyperventilation. Does anyone here not know hyperventilation? One person that doesn't. You know it for sure. It's been removed! DMCA takedown. See, and the culture gets lost. Now we don't have our ABBA supply anymore. Let's see if demoscene TV works properly. Please work. Yeah. We'll be right back. time. So thanks everyone for coming and enjoy the rest of the party.